Everything that I've spread, praise the Lord forever. Let everything in my soul. Good morning,
Good morning,
everyone.
everybody. Welcome to our Sunday service, the 28th of February. It's March tomorrow. I can't believe it. Oh, my word.
February is always a short month, of course, but
It
it's
is.
even shorter. It's 28 days. I was trying to work out, about the leap year and all that kind of stuff. Can you explain that to me? Because I don't.
No.
No, okay, let's leave
I
it
really
there.
can't.
It's
Why?
like,
I don't know.
we've got 28 days in February now,
It'll
so
be something about the Earth's rotation around the sun isn't perfectly 365 days. It's a little bit longer,
but I
so
don't
then
think it is a
we're
leap year
shorter.
this year.
No, it's not. It's only on an even number. It's every 4 years. So last
So
year was a leap year.
how do they do a leap year then?
It's just an extra day.
An extra day is a
Yeah.
leap year.
Yeah.
Right, okay. I get you. I thought the leap year was one less of a day.
Oh, I get you. Right. Okay. No.
Never mind.
So last year, 2020,
Well,
was
that's one less day to get to June. Come on, June 21st. Some of you are thinking, Luke, don't get your hopes up. It's going to change. It may do, but at least the end is in sight. And I say, roll on, getting back to church, being able to sing in church, being able to, well, we can still clap and dance in church. Roll on, getting back to New Life Kids and rock stars, being with our children. Roll on, getting back to youth. Go on, sorry, you're going to.
in
In
person,
person,
not seeing our kids in a year.
roll on getting back to our life groups, being able to fellowship with each other, roll on going for a coffee after our Sunday service, roll on getting to see our families and our friends without limits, may I add, roll on being able to hug one another, roll on hopefully being able to go into a supermarket as we've just been, it's Thursday night. And having to wear a mask. I'm happy to wear a mask, but it'd be nice to go in without
Not
having
to.
to wear one. Roll on June.
Yeah.
Amen. Quicker
Yeah.
than I thought.
Yeah, it seems surprising. Like, really? But yeah, well, do they know about masks or is that going to be decided
They've
later?
not said.
Right.
They've not
So,
said. It
might still be wearing
could be like,
masks.
China wore masks up in the Far East,
They
not just China.
always do, don't
They
they, though?
always do. So it could be like that. Who knows? It
Could
could be
be.
like a, a recommended thing,
Right. I
shall we
get you.
say? But
Yeah.
who knows? I've not even read up on it. But yeah.
Well, I wonder if after, all these restrictions are lifted, if Zoom will be a thing of the past.
Well, you said, I hope so, didn't
I hope, oh, I think everyone does. I think our kids do. I think high school students have had it. I know everyone's had it uniquely difficult, but I think high school students have had it particularly rough.
I mean,
I think, their whole futures are being decided from their grades and that, and now they don't know how it's going to be calculated, and they're under so much stress, and they have to sit there doing their classes online and talking about summer schools, and it's not fair. So I think
Well,
they've had it quite rough.
some of our youth literally like go on Zoom from 9 till 3, 4, and then they come on our Zoom
Yeah,
at 6,
yeah.
which, we make as fun as we can. But it's a long day on Zoom.
Yeah.
And it's exhausting, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. But yeah, I did hear they were talking about possibly doing summer, like in-person summer schools to like catch them up. And I was just like, oh my word, these kids, like they don't get a break. Like, does that mean they're not going to get a summer at all? So anyway, so hopefully all that kind of Zoom will be a thing of the past. Possibly some like remote working will stay, more people working from home and that would be nice. But hopefully, yeah, in terms of socializing, hopefully it will all be over and done with. Well, we've done quite a lot of Zooms,
We have.
and especially with the
I was
youth.
trying to count the other day how many Zooms. I know Kevin probably does Zoom a lot more. I know he meets with a lot of people on Zoom, but yeah, I feel like we've done quite a lot of Zoom.
Yeah, and we had to kind of figure out how to make it a bit more exciting with our youth. So we got a list of games together, and we've chosen our top three games to show you. And we will play one of them. So one of our favorites is called What's Changed, and this is where it's good if you have a background with like quite a bit going on. We sit in our kitchen and we do it, but you can do it on a plain background as well, and just like change something about your appearance. So the idea is you turn off your camera, so you let everyone have a look at you or have a look at your background.
So for instance, easy one. So we'll go like that. And then we'll go, what's
What's
changed?
changed?
Obviously
Yeah.
that was an easy one.
Yeah, so you turn off your camera, you change something about your background or about your appearance, and turn your camera back on, and everyone else has to figure out what you've done. So that's our first one.
Yeah, what's changed? It's a good one. Oh, I'm going on the notices here. Apologies. Our number two, and these aren't in really any order. We've got more than three, but real or unreal. So this one's a good one, easy one to do. Not really one just for Zoom. Basically, you pick a category. So we've had quite a lot of categories on our Youth Zoom. And you have to pick, or you have to think of something. Either it can be a real thing. So, for instance, one of them was place names in Australia, because we had a couple of Australian fellows on our Youth, which is great. So they did place names in Australia. So they either made one up, or they picked a real one, and it can be an obscure one to make the game harder, and we have to guess whether it's real or not real.
Yeah, yeah. There's all kinds of fun categories, like paint colours. Like,
yeah, that's yeah. Funny.
I think we've got some IKEA furniture.
Yeah.
And finally, what is it?
What is it?
Describe and draw. Is that, yeah.
Yeah.
I get you.
Different names.
He's put them in a different order. I thought I was doing the other one. Anyway, what is it? It's you look around your room or around your house, and you find kind of a unique object or something that's a bit funny.
Something really unique.
Yeah, yeah. Or it can be an ordinary thing, but you describe it in kind of obscure terms, and everybody else has to draw what you're describing. And then they all reveal their drawings, and then you reveal what the object was.
Yeah, cool. Well, I think we should play one of these now. And there's only one that probably really plays, of course, well for us in this situation. We're not on Zoom. But we're going to play real or not real. So it's nothing to do with deal or no deal. I was thinking then. Real or not real. And as Jenna said, this is IKEA furniture. Okay, so we've got five pieces of furniture. Some of them are real, some of them are not real. So the first one is a double bed called Song Esand. Is that real or is that not real? Song Esand. And don't Google and cheat. As you know, the reason why IKEA is a fun one is because they have some obscure names.
Yeah.
Because it's Scandinavian.
Well, I think that's
right.
Why things like paint colours can be so funny. Cause
yeah.
There's some daft names, yeah. Like daffodils in the spring.
Yeah.
Like,
some cool ones, though.
Yeah.
Coconut juice. We went looking at
coconut juice. That's coconut it. Juice. Like, yeah. They name them after places as well sometimes.
Yeah.
This one, I don't know. I think it's real.
Think it's real, Jana?
Yeah.
You guys think it's real? It is real.
Yay.
And this is a double. This is the double bed. It's got a bit of storage.
Good
there
looking
underneath.
Double bed.
Nice looking double bed. Yeah.
Yeah.
I like IKEA. Simple.
Yeah.
You know, they're not over.
Yeah.
How about this one? It's a sofa. Landskrona. Landskrona. Is that real, or is that not real? Landskrona.
I'm gonna go for real again.
I'm gonna go for real again.
I don't know if I'm doubting your ability to make up good words.
Well.
But I'm going to go for real.
You're going to go for real. You are correct. And there's the Landskrona. Big couch, big corner, five-seater apparently. That is the Landskrona.
Gosh, it looks like it fits about 10.
A rug. Slower bolt. Is that a real or is that not real? Slower bolt.
I'm going to go for real again.
Going to go for real
again? Yeah, I am.
Slowly. You guys at home, what are you thinking? I mean, you can only talk to the screen. Okay?
You can write in the comments how many you got right.
It is not real. It's actually faster bolt is the real one. So it's not slower bolt. Mm. So it's, there it is, the rug.
It's a nice rug.
Beautiful.
As well.
Just the corner of it.
A TV unit, Copenhagen.
Copenhagen.
Ooh, very interesting. I don't know. I'll go for real. I'll stick with...
Real. You've gone for real on all of them.
I
You've
have.
Got to be right on some. What you guys think at home? Is it real or not real?
Of Copenhagen TV unit.
It
not
is
real.
Not real.
Ah, Stockholm.
Well, the thing is, it was a bit of a trick question because Stockholm is in Sweden. IKEA is Swedish. Jysk, however, if you've been to Jysk, and we like Jysk, is Danish. So I would imagine they have some sort of furniture that's called Copenhagen.
Probably, yeah.
Capital of Denmark,
I should have
right?
thought that one through, really. But anyway, I just
anyway.
Last one.
Last one.
Pepperholmen. Guiding chair.
Pepperholmen.
That's a cool name. Ah, I'll go for real. We've had two not real in a row.
Okay, go for real.
Go for real.
It is not real. It's Saltholmen. Saltholmen. So there it is. Quite a basic little like chair there.
I know all of these words obviously mean something.
Yeah. Well, actually, they don't.
Saltholmen, does that not mean
some anything? Of them do. Google Translate, some of them are like nothing.
Right. Well, I like the sound of Pepperholmen.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. But next time you go in IKEA, write some down, the most obscure ones that you can find, or you can Google as well, because there's some real funny ones for sure.
Yeah. I like doing obscure English villages as well. Those are quite funny.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a good one. Yeah. That was a good one. I can't really remember one top of.
I can't, but there's some rude ones.
Yes.
Some funny ones.
Yeah.
So, yeah. All good. Okay. But we're going to head to Phil now, and he's got our joke of the week.
Good morning, church. Hope you're all very well. I went to the doctor's the other day and I said, "Doctor, I'm in real trouble. One minute I think I'm an awning, the next a marquee." He said, "Calm down, you're too tense." Take care, folks. Have a great day.
That is brilliant. That is brilliant. I like the clever ones. I like the ones.
Too tense.
Play on words and stuff.
Very good. Well, we've just got our usual notices today. Today, following the service, we've got our coffee and Zoom at 11:40. And then later on, we've got our New Life Kids at 2 p.m. with me and Luke.
Yeah.
And then this week, all the standard reflections and videos. So Paul, Monday night church at 8 p.m. That's live on Facebook. And I think it also goes on
the website as well. Yeah.
Tuesday at noon, we've got prayer and communion. And Kevin's leading that again. Wednesday at 9:30, the reflection is with Luke. And Friday at 9:30, Henry is doing the reflection.
Cool. And ahead of time, Kevin did show in more detail about this, but we have an online Easter conference. We've never done this before in a long time. Kevin said we used to call them the Easter convention. Well, it's kind of returned in a way. We've got guest speakers. Two amazing guest speakers, actually. Becky Murray from One by One and also James Aladarian from Prayerstorm, based in Manchester. Oh, wonderful. So we have sessions on Friday. We have sessions, two sessions on Saturday. And we have another one session on Sunday. So four sessions. Kevin, Becky, James, myself on Sunday. So it's going to be a great weekend. And it's called The Weekend That Changed the World. So it is going to be awesome, and it's completely free as well. They say nothing in life's for free, but that's what my dad said anyway. But this one is free. But it really was the weekend that changed the world, wasn't it? It really was the weekend that changed our world, my world. It really did change my world. I just thank Jesus for what he's done in my life. And that's why we're going to come around the Lord's table now and take communion together. Thank the Lord for what he's done through his death on the cross and his resurrection.
Well, I thought I'd read a little passage from Galatians. It's a really nice one. I was just reminded of it today. And just reminded because it really spoke to me as I was growing as a Christian. So I'll start in Galatians 2, starting in verse 15. So Paul is writing to the Jews, and he says, "You and I are Jews by birth, and not sinners like the Gentiles. Yet we know that a person is made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ, not by obeying the law. And we have believed in Christ Jesus, so that we might be made right with God because of our faith in Christ, not because we have obeyed the law. For no one will ever be made right with God by obeying the law. For when I tried to keep the law, it condemned me. So I died to the law. I stopped trying to meet all its requirements so that I might live for God.
Yeah.
My old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me.
Wow.
So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me.
Hmm.
I think this just reminds us what Jesus came to do on the cross. It's not by anything that we've earned or by being born into a certain bloodline, as Paul was getting at the start. You know, we're Jews, but that doesn't automatically make you right with God. And it's not because of the things we do that keeps us right with God. And it's not because of the things we don't do that keeps us right with God. He says that in the middle. I skipped it.
Mm.
It's only because of our faith in Jesus and our continued faith in him that makes us right with God. And so we thank Jesus for what he did on that Easter weekend.
Yeah.
That made it possible for us to be right with him. And Paul even says that when we trust in him, our old self is crucified. It doesn't live anymore, but we live through faith in him.
Amen.
And I don't think that means, well, I think Paul says that doesn't necessarily mean we stop forever sinning, but we stop walking in that pattern of sin and that just that mindset that the rest of the world has. We have a new mind and we have a new self, and he's done it all because he loved us and he gave himself for us. So we'll take communion now and then I'll pray for us. Thank you. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for what you did for us on the cross. Thank you, God, that by faith in you, that you put to death our old self and that you make us new, Jesus. Thank you that you fill us with your life. And in this act of communion, God, we remember that it's your life inside of us and not ours, and that you gave your life for us, God. So we thank you for that. We thank you that you make us new. And we thank you that you continue to make us new every day. Thank you that you've done all this because you loved us.
Yeah.
And we just pray that we would continue trusting in you and not trusting in the things that we do or by virtue of the fact that we, you know, grew up in a Christian home and have always gone to church. God, I pray we wouldn't trust in those things, but that we would trust in you and you alone and what you've done for us, God. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for this new life that you give us, God. We love you so much, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, it's our treat this morning that Paul Wood is sharing with us. As many of you know, Paul's been doing a great job with Monday Night Church every Monday. And we're so blessed by everything that God has given him to say. And he's given him more to say today. So he's gonna give us a message, and he's also at his AOG ministry and training interview this week, and he said it's gone really well. He's just waiting to hear back about that, so keep on praying for Paul and his family. So here's Paul with today's message, and the title is "There Is Hope." God bless you and see you at 11:40.
See you then.
Bye.
Good morning. What a privilege it is to be able to come to you this morning with this word from God. And I thank God for this opportunity. I hope you're well this morning. So, shall we just pray before we start? Thank you, God, for this morning. Thank you, God, for this day. Thank you, God, that you love us so much. And Lord, I just pray that what I say is of you, and that people's hearts and minds will be touched right now. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, Bless you. Thank you for joining this morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Paul, and I run something called Monday Night Church. And if you've not been tuning in, it is on a Monday night on the Monday Night Church Facebook page at 8 o'clock. Every Monday, it's just a reflection, part of the reflections, which happens on a Monday, Wednesday, and a Friday. But before lockdown, before we usually meet at Stanbridge Lane Community Centre in Kettlethorpe, and we go out and do outreach within Kettlethorpe. So that's what I do from within New Life, as part of, as well as being part of the senior leadership team. And I'm married to Sarah, and I have three boys, Noah, Isaac, and Elijah. That's for those of you who don't know me. Now, I was praying to God today for this privilege of what to bring this morning. And God really put on my heart that to make this personal. And what I meant by that is, really to tell my story, but to tell you that there is hope. From my own experience, that there is hope. And I've titled this just that, that there is hope. Now, over the last, you can say year now, the last year or so, things have been really, really tough for everybody. Everyone, things have been really tough. And as we know, over the next few weeks, things are going to start to unwind a little bit, but things are still going to be tough for a few months, possibly years to come, because of the repercussions of what's happened. But I know from my own personal experience in life that as a Christian, just because we're Christians doesn't mean we get away with things. Just because we're Christians doesn't mean we don't suffer. Now, we suffer just as Jesus suffered on the cross. He suffered the Almighty for us. You know, nothing can... how can I put it? Compare to what Jesus has done for us on the cross. But in my life, 10 years ago, I had to start my life again. My first wife died after 4 months of marriage. Life suddenly was a blur. What do I do now? The pain of grieving lasted what felt like quite a long time. But I had to go through that pain as a process to be where I am now. But the thing is, during that time and through that pain of grieving, I did not once look away from God. I knew Gloria had been healed. Even though she wasn't here anymore, that she'd been healed. She'd gone to heaven. You could say she's gone home. And, you know, Gloria's faith was amazing. And, you know, she came from, originally from a very, very poor country called Malawi, in Southern Africa. and she came from an amazing family. And I'm still very close to that family. But you know, I stood firm with God. I stood firm with Him. I trusted in Him, even though I was going through a very tough time. I looked to God provided the right people around me. Even at the time, I couldn't see 2012, I couldn't see ahead. I was in pain, grieving. Only when I got to August of 2013, when I went back to Malawi for a second time, did I then realise and feel that the time was right to move on. At this point, I'd moved to my own house in Hull. And I was able to spend time with Gloria's family in Malawi for 6 weeks in this preparation of moving on, speaking with them. And then I came back to the UK. While I was in Malawi, God really used me. I preached every week. Now, this is me. Before that, I wouldn't believe I could stand in front of people and preach. But God used me in an amazing way. And I knew from that moment on, what God wanted me to do, not just in Malawi. Now, also, it was time to move on. And in 2014, God did something special. I trusted in Him, I believed in Him. I met someone called Sarah. And I moved to Wakefield. I met Noah. And I moved to Wakefield. And God has blessed me because I trusted in Him. And I've also, obviously now I've said, but I've got, there's Isaac and Elijah. I'm married to Sarah and I've got 3 boys. But just because I've been through the grieving process with Gloria, life still has had its ups and downs. When Isaac was born, he wasn't very well. He still has his health issues now. In fact, all three, Noah, Isaac and Elijah, all have health issues. And so does Sarah. Sarah's been in hospital. Most of you know, with anaphylactic shocks, it's not been an easy 2 years for us. But you know what? There is hope. There is hope. And there's plenty of verses in the Bible which mention about there is hope. In Isaiah 40:31, it says this, "But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." Isaiah 40:31. "But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." If we hope in the Lord, put our hope in Christ Jesus, our strength will be renewed. I remember being in that hospital when Gloria was dying. And I actually said to God, I remember saying, I go into the toilet, and I remember saying, how much stronger can you make me? But it wasn't my own strength. I didn't do any of how I got through it. I couldn't have done it on my own. I did it through God's strength. And I'm still doing things right now in God's strength. I wouldn't be here preaching to you this morning if it wasn't for God. For God's love for me. For God's love for his strength. We soar on wings like eagles. You know, there's times in life when we think we can't pray. But God holds us up on wings like eagles. And we keep going. We do not become weary. We walk and not faint. But only through God, through the Lord, can we do this. If you put your hope in anything else or in someone else, I'm afraid you're going to come up short. And I know that through my own experience in life. Life is much harder when we rely on the flesh. But when we trust in the Lord, you know, we can become so strong through God. You know, even in the last few years, when we've had to deal with Sarah's anaphylactic shocks, and especially in the last 12 months, she hasn't had one since July. And we praise God for that, and we keep praying that there's no more. But last year, during lockdown, she had 3 of them. And I had to look after the boys during lockdown. And it was tough. But we got there. We got through. Again, God provided. God gave us strength. The boys were amazing people. When I say God provides, he just provides finances. He puts people in your way who are going to help. If you trust in God and you were in a church family, people help. And food was provided. We didn't have to do any shopping. People were absolutely amazing. And we never asked for anything. God provided. God knew what we needed. There is hope only in God. Over the last 12 months, what you may have gone through or still going through, I understand. If you're grieving right now, if you are grieving the loss of a loved one over the last 12 months or even longer, can I say be nice to yourself? Because God loves you. Sometimes we don't know why things happen. And yes, life is hard on our own. When we live, I get living in a house on our own when there's no one to talk to. I get that. I've been there. But when we trust in God and keep going, Keep walking. Keep walking in faith. God will get you through. And the grieving process isn't just for a month or 2 months or a year. It can be longer, but it all depends. Sometimes. But you will come through the other side when you trust in God. You know, life in the last 12 months has been really hard. Not being able to see each other, not being able to hug one another, not being able to see our own parents or brothers and sisters or relations we need to see, we'd like to see. But there is hope. There's hope through God that things will get better. We have to trust in God alone. You know, I have a favorite song. It's one of my most favorite songs, and I'm going to come back to it later. But it's called "In Christ Alone." You probably know it. It's an old song, probably now. But the title is "In Christ Alone, My Hope Is Found." You know, there's many other people in the Bible who have suffered. And even Paul, I want to look at Paul for a moment, who suffered. He was in chains. And in 2 Timothy 2 verses 8 to 10. It says this. Remember, Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But God's word is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they too may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Paul suffered. Paul was chained. But like he says here, God's word was not chained. So Paul suffered. So that other people could obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus. People came to know the word. People came to know Jesus. You know, in the last 12 months, we might be restricted. It may be hard for us to reach one another. But God's word is alive. There is hope. There is hope in Jesus. Jesus is alive today, tomorrow, and forever. Because Jesus died on the cross for us and rose again on the third day as accordance with the scriptures. That is it, he rose again. That's the important part. He rose again. And when he ascended into heaven to be at the right hand of the Father, it had to happen so that we could be filled with the Holy Spirit if we believe and trust in him. We are filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is with us. Jesus is with us. God is with us. And you too, today, if you don't know Jesus, can also have this amazing gift. It's only in Christ alone where we find hope. And it's only because Christ died on the cross for us that there is hope. I'm here today to tell you that there is hope. I wouldn't be here right now with you right now if it weren't for God, what God has done in my life. What he did and what he's done over the last 10 years has been amazing. And I know there's more blessings to come from God. There's possibly more sufferings along the way. But do you know what? Only through Christ there is hope, and we can get through this. In Christ alone, our hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone my hope is found. Christ is my light. Christ is my strength. Christ is my song. Firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love. God is up there. What depths of peace. Just imagine that right now. Fears are stilled. Strivings are ceased. Christ is my comforter. He is my all in all. And here today, in the love of Christ, I stand before you. Today, whatever you're going through, there is hope. Look to Christ alone, no one else. Make him your light and your strength and your song. Let him be your comforter, your all in all. And then, in the love of Christ, you will stand. Shall we pray? Father God, just thank you so much that you love every single one of us. And it says in your word that you want no one to suffer. Father, I just thank you that there is hope. Through you, there is hope. There is hope in life. We can gain strength from you. We can soar on eagle's wings. And we can stand here because of you. You are our light, our hope, our strength. And we thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. Enjoy the rest of your day. Take care.